This is the North Africa Journal, and thank you for downloading this podcast. For more podcasts, information, and user rules, please visit north-africa.com/podcast.
News Talk on demand. Interruption-free audio, where you want it, when you want it.
John Gormley, thank you for being here, and welcome wherever we find you. If I say NDP and natural governing party to you, what would you say? Oh, chapter one of Gormley's book. That's the first chapter in my best-selling book, Saskatchewan's NDP and how they're the natural governing party. I'm not talking about the increasingly hapless gang of socialists called the NDP, no! I am talking about the party that since 1954, the National Democratic Party, which has governed Egypt. Now, Egypt is not, in your sense and mine, the democracy that we would be accustomed to. It is propped up, supported by, and in many respects, sanctioned or permitted in the political structure by the military. Whether it was from 1954, the party of Gamal Nasser, if you're a certain age, you'll remember President Nasser. I remember coming of age during the time of the Mideast peace talks involving Anwar Sadat. And you remember the terrible assassination of President Sadat. Then the ascension of his second-in-command, the man who has governed Egypt for the last 30 years, Hosni Mubarak, now in his early 80s. And as the demonstrations, the virtual riots have continued and the unrest on Egypt, what does all of this mean for stability in the Middle East? And that may be an oxymoron at the best of times, but certainly in Egypt. Writing in the North Africa Journal, Alessandro Bruno says, end of the road for Mubarak. Now, Mr. Bruno is not just the deputy editor of the North Africa Journal. He is someone well acquainted with many publications here, as well having done an MA in Middle Eastern Studies, a bachelor in Near Eastern Studies, and has done a number of postgraduate courses as he's moved toward a PhD in Middle Eastern Studies. We find him in Toronto today. Alessandro, thanks for taking our call.
Good morning.
Walk me through the tenuous or delicate relationship that exists with this powerful military structure in Egypt and who the military effectively allows to govern.
Well, ever since the monarchy was toppled in Egypt in 1952, and you remember Egypt had a king until the 50s, the army has held power because, first of all, all presidents in Egypt have come from the army, from Nasser to Sadat to Gamal Mubarak. Hosni Mubarak. You may remember Hosni Mubarak was the head of the Air Force and was a pilot during one of the Israeli-Arab wars in '67, I believe. He was trained in the Soviet Union, and Sadat was also an army officer, and Nasser came from the army. So the army was the initial institution that toppled the monarchy, and it held sway throughout the years through this so-called the party called the National Democratic Party. But really, the National Democratic Party is controlled by the army.
So the demonstrations and the riots going on, does the army take sort of a hands-off role? I mean, what does it, if you put yourself in the position of the generals, you know, aside from Mubarak and the politicians, what is the army doing in all of this?
Well, this is the interesting thing. You've seen images of citizens and soldiers embracing and sitting on tanks, and you know, even that, if you've noticed, some of the tanks have graffiti on them. So this is because, of course, the army, being the largest institution in Egypt, is also a conscript institution. So every family in Egypt probably has at least one or two members in the army, whether they like it or not, because you're drafted. So the army is seen as having a direct relationship to the people, whereas the police force is not like that. The police force has earned a far worse reputation than the army because particularly the secret police, the police that controls telephone calls and your conversations and who you interact with on the street, or which neighbors you talk to and what you tell those neighbors. That is the real hated institution. The army also enjoys a great deal of respect, because during the Arab-Israeli wars in 67-73, the Egyptian army was considered to have done a very good, an overall very good performance. They fought courageously and honorably. So the army is, although having propped the NDP, also enjoys a very important and solid reputation with the man on the street.
Alessandro Bruno is with us. He's a deputy editor of the North Africa Journal. He writes, End of the Road from Mubarak, the latest update. So help me out with who these people are on the streets. I mean, I look at this thing, and I remember, quote, the student protests in Iran, and look where that led us. You look at the Muslim Brotherhood, which you write has more power on the street than it does in the parliament. Is there the beginning of this kind of grassroots movement that then creates an Islamic theocracy?
Well, the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt is much older than any of the Islamic parties that then took over power in Iran. And by the way, the Iranian revolution did not start out as an Islamist revolution. It started out actually as a mishmash of, like the one in Egypt, a mishmash of ideologies that then came together and were sort of hijacked by the Ayatollahs.
Exactly.
In Egypt, Egypt is where the concept of the Muslim Brotherhood, the Islamic parties, was actually born by a man called Hassan al-Banna in the 1930s, and a number of intellectuals that developed the concept over the years. Some of them were murdered in jail. In fact, that's one of the legacies of Egypt. A man called Sayed Kubt was murdered in the 1960s, wrote an important book on the subject. What we're seeing on the street is not just Islamists. The Muslim Brotherhood, in fact, their main source of support comes from the fact that they filled in the role of the government in social services. So where the government has failed Egyptians in providing, say, basic health care or even employment services, or let's say you need your son wants to go to university, you don't have money, you go to sometimes you can go to a Muslim Brotherhood chapter and in your neighborhood, and they'll help you out. They'll give you loans. It's what Hamas has done in the Palestinian territories. It's very similar to Hamas, actually, the way the Muslim Brotherhood has worked. And over the years, the most radical that the Muslim Brotherhood became was in the early 80s when Sadat was murdered. But since then, they've really toned down, and they've become an actual political force, so much so that they ran for elections in several occasions, and most notably in 2005, they earned almost a quarter of parliamentary seats, running, though, as independents. They didn't run. The government prevented them from running under the name Muslim Brotherhood. They ran as independents, although everyone knew that they were Islamists, because their slogan was simply Islam is the solution. So basically, they provide. That's how they gained the population support, through social services. In fact, you may have heard that during the riots, they've set up clinics to help the wounded. So that's their typical role. The problem with the Muslim Brotherhood, and why I think it doesn't enjoy that widespread parliamentary support, it enjoys support on the street, is because it doesn't really have any answers for real political problems that countries face as a whole. It's good as a community organization, but not at a macro level. It doesn't really offer major economic solutions, or although it claims to, through Islamic banking and so on. But really, the Muslim Brotherhood also has won seats in parliament in Jordan, and they've actually lost popularity. Once they get into parliament, they tend to lose popularity. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting. Perhaps that's the best a way to deal with them, is to tone them down, is to allow them in Parliament and having them confront real problems and real issues.
Alessandro, can you hang on for a sec?
Sure.
Alessandro Bruno is with us, the deputy editor of the North Africa Journal. So when he says the road is, the end of the road has been reached for Hosni Mubarak, so what happens next? That's my next question to Mr. Bruno as we return on this update on the unrest in Egypt. I'm John Gormley. This is News Talk Radio. I'm John Gormley. Alessandro Bruno is here. He is the deputy editor of the North Africa Journal, writing just last week, End of the Road for Mubarak, the update. Alessandro, why do you argue this is the end of the road in Egypt for President Mubarak?
Well, we've seen an unprecedented uprising. I've never seen anything like this in Egypt, and certainly this is completely inspired by the success of Tunisians in getting rid of their president. Tunisia also had a police state, tight controls, and they defied all the theories. Basically, we were told that for many years that unless a movement had a real identifiable leader and a party to guide it, there was no way they could break through. Instead, we've had the very opposite, a mishmash of groups completely independent of each other coming together, sparked by a few incidents in Tunisia. It was the self-immolation of the street vendor who was humiliated, and that has sparked a wave throughout the region, which will soon reach other countries, inevitably.
See, my fear, and you made the point so well, is you have this disparate group of people who say, we've had enough. So they rise up. My fear, of course, is if the Islamists take over, and you say they're nonviolent, I'm a bit more skeptical and concerned, but I think you and I agree, Islamists are no fun. Yes. They're people who would shut Egypt down, in terms of tourism and extending itself to the rest of the world. Islamists would have none of that.
No, that's the problem. But of course, Islamists, there are different degrees.
Right.
Those are the extremists. I think the Muslim Brotherhood has come to terms with some of Egypt's realities. The Muslim Brotherhood has grown over the years, and at the official level, at least the ones who are represented in Parliament, are people who have to deal with practical day-to-day solutions, and that's how they've made their success within their community. In fact, that's really the success of the Muslim Brotherhood doesn't come from any ideological position. It comes because they've provided social services where the government has failed.
Right. So help me out with the two other names we keep hearing, Omar Suleiman, the head of Egyptian intelligence, and Mohamed Barade, the man who was part of the International Atomic Agency, part of the UN. Is it one of these two who begin to emerge even as an interim leader?
I think both of them are, in different steps. I think Omar Suleiman, the head of intelligence, who's made his experience really arresting the more extremist elements. In fact, he really came to the fore after the assassination of President Sadat, in charge of arresting those responsible. You may remember a certain al-Zawahiri. Of al-Qaeda fame. Yeah, he was one of the ones involved in the assassination of President Sadat.
And he's bin Laden's second in command.
Yeah,
now.
Suleiman is the army's man. The army appointed him to make sure that they keep some control, and I think his role will be to lead Egypt toward the presidential election, which was already scheduled for September. And I think the people would accept, although they're saying, we want the system down, I think they would accept an interim, guaranteed interim period led by Suleiman to stabilize the situation, through which then El Baradei, the other figure that's emerged as a popular, El Baradei can gain a seat in Parliament. So far he doesn't have one. Engage the other parties and form a coalition, probably even involving the Muslim Brotherhood, and then present himself as a candidate for the presidency in September.
So would that start to, if he can get this coalition, would that start to actually democratize Egyptian politics?
Well, yes, that's really, there's no turning back now. This is the only solution short of I don't know, dare I say it, a civil war. They need to, I think this is the most realistic solution right now. The army itself knows this. The army, I think, understands that the game will be played in a different way from now on. And they will have to have, this is, you know, the course to take, otherwise violence will continue. I think Mubarak, I don't know, he's 82 years old. He must be thinking that he can survive. Because if I were Mubarak, I would have resigned days ago. You know, he's still hanging on. And I think he's remembering something that happened in 1977, the famous bread riots. Sadat was president. 900 people were killed in the streets of Cairo. They were protesting the government's lifting of food subsidies, and the violence was tremendous, and they were also demanding that Sadat step down. But Sadat stayed on and used repressive violence to control those riots. I think Mubarak is thinking that maybe he can still survive despite what he's seen on the street. And the first thing he could do to calm down the population would be to declare officially, my son, Gamal, will not run, because that's another issue. It also involves Suleiman. This Vice President Suleiman and head of security was for many years thought to be the natural successor to the presidency. But in the last few years, he was sidelined by Mubarak because he was trying to make room for his own son. So that's one of the reasons that the people are actually very angry with Mubarak. He wanted to initiate a dynastic approach. We've seen in Egypt, actually, the dynastic approach hasn't worked for presidents. And all presidents have died in office.
All right, Alessandro Bruno. Boy, this has been a very enlightening run through this. And if people want to read more, they can go to north-africa.com. And that's where the North Africa Journal is found. And I know as the writer for that, we'll be following in the coming days. Thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
Take care. Alessandro Bruno in Toronto, a guy who's lived in Egypt, lived in Libya, spent a lot of time in the Middle East, including some work as a program officer with a UN development program, done a number of academic papers over the years. He says Hosni Mubarak is on his way out, and you've seen him connect some of the dots for what could happen in the continuing unrest in Egypt. I'm John Gormley. This is News Talk Radio.
This was the North Africa Journal podcast. Thank you for listening.